We acknowledge and honor the Pechanga Band, one of seven bands that call themselves the Payam-Kuikim people, which means the people of the West, and upon whose ancestral land we worship today. We recognize with gratitude these Pechanga elders, past and present, who have and continue to care for this region. We seek to partner in continuing this stewardship and working for just peace.
Welcome to the United Church of the Valley. As a progressive Christian community, we believe that following the path and teachings of Jesus can lead us to an experience of the sacred and oneness and unity of all life. UCV is a community in which individuals can live out their inner callings to a variety of ministries. We collect supplies and provide meals to help combat homelessness and supported by the Southwest Action Group. We raise money and supplies for international relief effects such as Chaka Seca and Ukraine. Some help plan and lead worship. We support Pilgrim Pines which is our church camp in Oak Glen. And we also have a camp in Minto, Block 11. The Marietta Food Pantry, Emily's Place, and the farm workers in Duluth. We also participate in the Interfaith Council of Miss Valley. We also support each other. We have church school for adults and children and study groups for adults. Welcome to you who are here in the building, and welcome to you who are joining us online. I can't see anybody there. Okay, wait.
They can't see you either if you have paper up. Here you go.
No, I'm done.
Okay. Well, I was just checking if I had anything on the other side of our. We love you, Donna. I'll be back.
Invite your friends. I invite all of your minds to go from wherever they're wandering and to come right here. The world can get along without us for an hour, don't you think?
Amen.
Because right now we're doing this, and so our minds can be here doing this. And then we'll do that later, whatever that is. So now we get to sing it in this song that we do here called A Breathe In. It's a nice mindful song. What it means is just be here with your breath. Even if you pause right now and just notice the breath, just notice it. You don't have to describe it. You can feel it. Coming in maybe through your nose, hits the back of your throat here, feels a little cool. You can feel your chest rise, and you can feel your chest fall. And that's what this song is about, is being part of our own body and being part of the world. There's a place in here that says it's then rising like a stalk of grain, which just pulls us right here into the world, which we are a part of. 119 elements, that's all there is. Everything is made of that. Me and you, 11 elements, most of us, meaning we're more alike than different. And so we're going to welcome our day. Good morning.
Good morning.
How's everyone today? Thank you, Darcy and Ruth and the whole Dunlop musical ensemble over there. I'm going to tell a story real quick before I start with the call to celebration, because this, my sermon comes from a series that I did years and years ago about vacations and about lessons that I've learned on vacations. And as always, when we were on our way here today, I was thinking about one of the coolest vacations I've ever taken, which was to the Holy Land in 2011. That was definitely a bucket list, right? And maybe I've told this story here before, maybe I haven't. One day we went to the Dead Sea. I told you that story, the Dead Sea story. So we went to the Dead Sea, and the reason the Dead Sea is called that is because it's too dense in minerals for anything to live. So literally nothing lives in the Dead Sea. It is, if somebody likes, what's it called, Glen Ivy, or maybe you have won the lottery and have enough money to go to the new one off of Merritt Hot Springs, the old Calvary Chapel. The Dead Sea is like those. It's just full of minerals, right? And it's called the Dead Sea because nothing will live in it, literally. And I remember that day I was self-conscious. I didn't want to get in my bathing suit. It was super overcast. It was a little chilly. I was like, I'm not getting in the Dead Sea today. And then something in me said, when are you going to be in the Dead Sea then? So the people I were traveling with, they're like, nah, we're sitting this one out. Steph. And I was like, okay, fine. And so I took a couple steps in to the Dead Sea, and it really is like that clay that you spend a lot of money on at Nordstrom's to put on your face, and it just makes your body feel so incredible. But the denseness of the Dead Sea is this, that I was probably about mid-thigh deep, when all of a sudden I was lifted. Because it's too heavy now for you to walk in any deeper. So you're literally floating on the Dead Sea. And it was this sort of almost out-of-body experience, sort of surreal experience of, you know, I'm a great swimmer, and we go to the pool all the time, and we swim all the time, and I know how to float. But it was the first time in my life that I felt like something else was holding me. And as I was listening to the music of Summertime, and I was listening to the Breathe In, I thought about that day at the Dead Sea, where I have no doing of my own, I was being held up. And I think about Sherry Ann right now, who is being held up, right? And all the rest of us, when we reach some times in our lives when all we need is for something else to hold us up. Call it God, call it each other, whatever you want to call it. But I remember that experience, and listening to the Breathe In, Breathe Out song made me feel like I should share that story. So if you ever go to the Holy Land, don't be embarrassed. Get in your bathing suit and go on the Dead Sea, because it is top three travel experiences of my life. All right, let's continue to center ourselves. With friends and strangers, with family and neighbors, we gather. Come among us, ever-present God, with your love and grace which never ends. With faith reaching out to grasp, with heart straining to trust, we hope. Come among us, merciful God, with your compassion and healing. With word and wonder, with silence and song, we worship.
Come among us, Spirit of God,
with your inspiration and encouragement, which gives us strength. With willing hearts to love our neighbors, with open arms to serve, will go.
Come among us, Christ our example, to lift us to our feet, to follow you.
Go, Lori.
And sort of lessons learned along the way. And you know, Sabbath rest, finding that stillness is a commandment in the creation story in Genesis, right? It says that God created for 6 days and then rested, even if God didn't know. And then all the time, as we're reading through the stories, right, of Jesus' life, it would be like he would go out, do ministry, and then he would take his disciples and be like, okay, now we need to sit. We need to pause, we need to retreat, and we need to go. And so many of the stories and the parables and even the miracles and the scriptures really are when people would go after to try to interrupt Jesus' rest, right? Where he was resting and trying to get refilled, and the crowds would find him. And they would sort of disturb this holy rest, and there was a story to be told there. A friend in one of my previous churches who I really respect and have a lot of honor for, she says the secret to life is to play part-time, work part-time, and rest part-time. And she really does act like she has 150% more than the rest of us. But I think it's the, you know, we're good at the work part-time, right? Or full-time, or maybe fuller than full-time. But making the time for that rest and that play and that space to be able to recenter ourselves and to refill ourselves. And so as I read the scripture today, you know, I'm very, very aware that 1 week from tomorrow I go back to work. Not 1 week, excuse me, 1 month. Excuse me. 1 month from tomorrow, I go back. Target,
anybody's been to Target, we're boycotting Target right now because they already have their back to school out, which is so incredibly rude. Somebody was like, well, they also have Halloween. I'm like, good for Halloween. Halloween doesn't scare me. Back to school does. And so I'm also really aware that I have another month to sort of refill and re-energize and be ready for my students. So anyway, I invite you to hear this word from John. After this, there was a festival of the Jews, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. Now in Jerusalem, by the sheep gate, there's a pool. In Hebrew, it's called Bethesda, which has five porticos. Now in these lay many invalids, blind, lame, and paralyzed. One man who was there had been ill for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and knew he'd been there for a long time, he said to him, "Do you want to be made well?" The sick man answered, "Sir, I have no one to put me into the pool when the water is stirred up. And while I'm making my way, someone else steps down ahead of me." And Jesus said to him, "Stand up, take your mat, and walk." At once, the man was made well, and he took up his mat and he began to walk. Now that day was the Sabbath. So the Jews said to the man who had been cured, "It is the Sabbath, it is not lawful for you to carry your mat." But Jesus answered them, "The man who made me well said to me, 'Take up your mat and walk.'" And they asked him, "Who is the man who said this to you? Take it up and walk." Now the man who had been healed did not know who it was, for Jesus had disappeared in the crowd that was there. Here ends the reading. Let us pray. May the words of my mouth and then the meditations of our heart and then the living out of these words be wholly acceptable to you, O God, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. My story is my birth mother died when I was very young, too. And my dad, well, we won't talk about how many marriages he's had since, but he married the woman who raised me, who I consider my mom, when I was six. And literally days after they got married at the old Crystal Cathedral, remember that place? It's now a Catholic thing. But there used to be this huge tower, and they got married on the top floor in the tower overlooking the Crystal Cathedral. And literally, so my mom, Faith, has two older kids that are older than me, and then there was me and my sister. And my oldest sister is about 15, 16 years older than me, and so she was married and already had a little boy. So my nephew is, you know, like 5 years younger than me. Super young, very, very young. But right after my parents got married, my sister's husband had joined the Air Force, and he got stationed in Salt Lake City. And then he was discharged from the military, or he finished his time. And then he became a police officer in Salt Lake City. And so it was our family traditions. The only vacations that I remember were with my sister and her family. She has three kids and us. And so either they would come and we'd spend a week in Oceanside or Carlsbad and then they'd stay with us for another, you know, month or so. Or we would pack up the Cadillac and we would drive to Salt Lake City with my mom and my dad and me and my sister in the back. And the way that my parents broke this up, not little people, like, why we need to stop so much, I honestly have no idea, but that just tells you how terrible of a child I was, but it was mostly my sister, but maybe me too. Anyway, so what they would do to break up the trip is we would always spend one night in Vegas and then one night in St. George. So it would be like 2 days to get there. And it was always my mom's job to book the hotels ahead of time. You know, old school, we'd have those, we'd go to AAA, remember these? Yeah. The trip tickets, and you'd like literally, honestly, it's like we were on a treasure hunt. Like, what in the world were we thinking? Anyway, we'd have this little trip ticket and be like, oh, we just passed there. Let's do it. Anyway, that's neither here nor there. Anyway, so one year my mom forgot to make the hotel reservations. My dad's like, it's fine, it's Vegas, there's going to be a hotel room. Well, we get to Las Vegas, and it just happened to be the weekend of the Lions convention. And there was literally not one hotel room in all of Las Vegas. My mom felt horrible. You know, those Lions, they wear those little pointy, like, anyway, they look like Curious George or something with the thing on their head. But anyway, my mom felt terrible, just terrible. Because, you know, my dad was used to, that was his stamina to make it to Las Vegas, right? And so she said, well, what are we going to do? What are we gonna do? Do you want me to drive? No, 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 I can drive, I'll drive. So he gets, he didn't drink coffee, but he got some sort of soda, he got some snacks, and we're driving through Eastern Nevada to make it to St. George, right? And he's got his window rolled down, it's hot. He's got his window rolled down, and the last I remember, his head was sort of sticking out the window a little bit like a puppy trying to just stay awake. And the rest of us were all sound asleep. And the way we were woken up was to this. You know those little things on the side of the road that they put there? In case somebody swerves off the road? Well, my dad had fallen asleep too, and unbeknownst to all of us, until those woke us up, we all had no idea. And of course, my dad ended up overcorrecting, and then there was a whole other thumping issue. We were all fine, and a little shaken up and startled, but really we were all fine, right? Now my dad was really weak. But I feel like the moral of that is, right, we all say that we're fine when we're not. Or we all say we can do it when we can't. And we want to camouflage how we're really doing, right? Because we don't want the world to see that we need help or that we're not okay. And so we know that we've heard other people tell us that they're fine, and we know they're not. But we don't ever want anybody to recognize that we're the ones who are not okay. And in this morning's text, right, Jesus comes across this man who needs help, which this month is a month of differing abilities for people with differing abilities, and this is a really good scripture, I think, to sort of kickstart the month. So Jesus comes across this man who needs help, and he's been waiting to be healed, and did you hear it? For 38 years. 38 years. And Jesus sees him there lying beside these healing pools. Same sort of thing as the Dead Sea, right? And the mineral water at Glen Ivy that you go in there and it'll bubble up. And sometimes it's really hot, but it's really good for your skin. And the story was that if you needed healing, you would make your way into these healing pools and you would be healed. I myself have visited these healing pools in Bethsaida. And when I traveled to Jerusalem, and there's five of them, and there's five small pools, and it doesn't look like a resort, like they've really kept the original, or what they say is the original meaning and look of what these healing pools would have looked like. And they're just five small little mineral pools. I mean, not too small, but not as big as this room, right? So it would be that you would be lowered into the healing pools, and that you could be healed. But what the scripture doesn't tell you, that you don't know until you go or you see pictures, is there's about 150 stairs. Because the pools are in the depths of the earth, right? And so, people who went to go be healed were that hurt. Because they were able enough to make it into the pools. Or they could pay someone to help them make it into the pools. And so in the text you hear the man say, I have tried to get to the pools, but usually when it's bubbling up, someone gets in my way. In other words, he had no help to get in to the depths of the earth where he could find his healing. And who knows, maybe he asked for help. Maybe he was like us sometimes and didn't want to ask for help. I can be assured, if it's 38 years, I'm going to ask at some point. And I remember thinking at the time, I was really young, I don't even know if I was 8 when this happened with my father. I remember thinking at the time, why didn't you just let mom drive? Why couldn't you just ask for help? But now I'm grown. And I know, right? When we're a child, there's this push and pull of, I'm going to ask for help or I'm not going to ask for help. I can do it and then I can't do it, right? And it's this whole sort of letting our kids gain their independence, not experiment, gain their independence, right? And what they're able to do, and that's how we teach them, and that's how we ourselves learn as well. But then something happens when we become an adult, and it's like we're less than, or we're weaker than, or, you know, without genderizing people.
I'm a man.
I can do it, right? And I'm not sure it's only one gender. But we're the people who like to help, right? We love to bring a casserole or flowers or send a card or visit someone, give to a worthy cause, sign up to go on a mission trip, right? To play the piano when our wife disappears with the guitar. Hold a vigil for democracy on the 4th of July. There's all kinds of ways we like to live out our faith, right? But for ourselves, it's easier said than done, right? To ask for that help, or to be open to that help, to say, carry me down the stairs to that healing spot, right? And then, of course, you know, this is a text that sometimes we read during Lent, because this starts the drumbeat of the holy people wanting to kill Jesus, because you broke a rule, you healed someone on the Sabbath, and then you made him break a rule because he picked up his mat, and you're not supposed to do that, because healing is only for 6 days a week, and never will you find it on the seventh. But I think the lesson learned for all of us in this is sometimes we do have to ask for help. Sometimes we can't make it to the depths for that healing spot on our own. And we need to know how to ask for help. May it be so. Amen. In our beloved community, people care about one another and share joys and sorrows and concerns, and every week we gather together to share our concerns for the community. So please join me in a moment of prayer as we lift up these names. We pray for peace and safety and justice, for all the world, but especially those who are currently experiencing escalating violence. Our heart breaks for the people of Israel and Palestine, Ukraine, Sudan, Haiti, Syria, Nigeria, Somalia, and Myanmar, and the others of deadly conflicts in our world. Comfort them, O God, even as your heart breaks. Protect them, even as you call for justice, and grant compassion for all of your people. Together we pray. Prayers. Prayers for Lori's son, Jason. Unfortunately, his cancer has gone to his lungs and spread, and so we keep Jason and Lori in our thoughts and our prayers. Together we pray. I have a concern here. I'm hoping it's supposed to be shared. It doesn't say not to. Prayers for Mr. R and his family. He's struggling with suicidal thoughts and on his way to the hospital. Together we pray. Prayers for Lorian for safe travel to visit her sister in Oregon, and also for Rose, who's struggling with a lot of pain in her stomach. Together we pray. Well, this is from Donna. Prayers for our camps. I saw you were at camp this last week. Prayers for our camps that are in session now. Together we pray. From Christy Clinton, prayers. She's been experiencing headaches for a few days and not feeling well. And also for her husband Mark's paperwork will go through for his medical disability. Together we pray. From Becky, continued prayers and support for Emily's space. Together we pray. And for our teachery type, I'm not sure if this is just in the teacher circles that people know this, but a lot of representatives from unions were at NEA, the largest teacher convention, and gathering nationally every single year in Philadelphia. And all these people traveled from afar, and the NEA support staff went on strike. And so no meetings were held. So all those people were just in Philadelphia, and so we prayed for the support staff. And of course, everyone's a union member, so no one's gonna cross any lines. So Lee and all the rest of them had a nice little vacation in Philadelphia as they keep the lines where they are. So prayers for the NEA support staff. Together we pray. Let us share together in a moment of holy silence. No matter how we understand prayer, we find that it is good to pray. Together we hold these names and words, spoken and unspoken, in a spirit of concern, a spirit of joy, and a spirit of connection, and now in prayer. O great love, thank you for living and loving in us and through us. May all that we do from our deep connection with you and all beings listen to our heart's longings for the healing of the world. We offer these prayers in all of the holy names of God. Amen. Now let us pray together our prayer that Jesus taught us, first the traditional version and then a more contemporary. Our God, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. Save us from our time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Loving Spirit, who is in heaven and within us, we call upon your names. Your wisdom come, your will be done, in all the spaces in which you dwell. Give us each day sustenance and perseverance. Remind us of our limits as we give grace to the limits of others. Separate us from the temptation of empire, but deliver us into your community. For you are the dwelling place within us, the empowerment around us, and the celebration among us, now and forever.
United Church of the Valley, we seek to be inclusive of all people. We strive for peace and justice among all people. We strive to protect and restore the integrity of our earth. We commit to a path of lifelong learning, compassion, and love. We invite you to be part of this mission, and we thank you for your generosity. Karen and passing an offering plate around, change plate. Okay. You can make donations by going to our website at ucv.org, where you can use either Venmo or PayPal. Of course, you can always mail checks to our mailing address at P.O. Box 1312, Marietta, California, 92564. Now is the time when we pass the peace as an act of forgiveness and reconciliation. Jesus told his disciples that before they come to be reconciled with God, they should first reconcile with one another. And so during this time of sharing Christ's peace, you are encouraged to seek and to offer forgiveness. When we turn to those around us with the greeting, may the peace of Christ be with you, and respond with, and with you also, we symbolize our unity, even in the midst of divisions. When we pass the peace, we practice God's call to make every effort to maintain the bond of peace. Let us wave our peace to each other. May the peace of Christ be with you, and also with you.
Weeks this balloon arch is gonna have me down. So we gather together for this time of to share in a holy meal. I remind you that this is an open table. All are open and welcome to receive, to take part in this meal. I was as Darcy was singing that song, our first song that we sang together, the Breathe In song, it reminded me of the prayer of St. Francis, so I would like to share that prayer as we gather together for communion. Oh God, make me an instrument of your peace. Where there is hatred, let me sow love. Where there is injury, pardon. Where there is doubt, faith. Where there is despair, hope. Where there is darkness, light. And where there is sadness, joy. O Divine Master, grant that I may not so much seek to be consoled as to console, to be understood as to understand. Imagine if we did that. To be loved as to love. For it is in giving of ourselves that we receive. It is in pardoning others that we are pardoned, and it is in dying that we are born to eternal life. Amen.
Give thanks for the bread.
Thank you.
bread of life and the cup of God's love poured out for you. Take it. Let us pray together. Holy God, we have eaten the bread and drunk the wine. We have been touched by your Spirit and are thankful. Still speaking, God, as we go from this place to be your church in the world, may the boldness of your Spirit transform us. May the gentleness of your Spirit lead us. May the gifts of your Spirit be our guide and strength, today and in the days to come. Amen. I invite you to stand as you're able as we sing our closing song. As you leave this place, walk with faith, live with hope, and serve with the love of God. Amen.